introductions right now.
Sure.
And then keep going.
Sure.
So, hi, I'm Erin Marchak. I work with My Planet out of Toronto. I am a associate director of Drupal practices, and one of the areas that I particularly enjoy focusing on is accessible development. And I have frequently had the pleasure of working with David.
Great. I'm David MacDonald, and I'm on the WCAG team, so I had a full head of hair when I began. That's what we were talking about yesterday. And my voice sounded really great. I tried to be a rock star, and it didn't work out so well for me, so I sound like this all the time now. So I know WCAG really, really well. I know I was involved with every fight and every vote of every success criterion. And don't ask how you make a hot dog, okay? That's the one thing you want to really make sure is that, you know, it's a messy process making a standard that's going to be worldwide because we have a lot of stakeholders, and we have to be able to balance the needs of people with disabilities with the needs of the developers. And to come up with success criteria that are achievable, testable, that are internationalized, you can internationalize them, you can go across languages, you can go across technologies, very, very difficult. So I've been with the WCAG team since 2002 now. So I know the standard really well. And feel free to ask me all those questions that you thought you'd never be able to get answered about WCAG. But today is about 2.1, and there's a lot of stuff to cover, so we'll be moving pretty quickly.
Cool. Yeah, so we'll be covering the updates to 2.1. We're not going to be covering anything regarding the 2.0 guidelines. A lot of the guidelines and the acceptance criteria are inherited from 2.0 to 2.1. But in general, how many people here are familiar with the guidelines individually? Yeah, okay, cool. So the point that I would like to identify here regarding the guidelines is just to remember everyone, since you already are familiar with them, is that they are technology agnostic. So this talk, while it won't be Drupal focused, since we are talking about technology agnostic guidelines, we're going to try and pull them in to how it's going to impact individuals who are working with Drupal from a development, site building, or theming perspective. So you kind of have an idea of what they'll look like from a guideline perspective, from a governance perspective, and from a practical application perspective.
Yeah, and the reason that they're technology agnostic is because technology changes how often? That's like, there's a t-shirt that says, as you read this, your computer just went obsolete, right? It takes about 10 years to get a standard, and it's going to be a lot quicker for WCAG 2.1, we're hoping, but it takes a long time, and technology is moving really quickly. So a very brilliant professor over at Madison, Wisconsin, Greg Vandenhuyden, came up with this idea, let's make technology agnostic. Pull out the idea behind it, formalize those, and then use our techniques to hang technical specifications off of them, and then that way we're changing nodes every 6 months under the WCAG process, but it's really difficult to get a standard view, so we can leave that language kind of evergreen. That's why WCAG 2.0 has lasted 3 years, and it's still pretty pertinent today, so we're just doing an update to it now.
And the cool part about the update is that you're using GitHub to actually version control and have discussions regarding the update. So these slides, which are available online now at emarchak.com/what's-new-in-WCAG, they all have links to the individual GitHub text files that are being used to edit. So if you can comment on, engage with, ask questions through GitHub issues. And we'll talk more about how you can do that.
Yeah, just one thing about that is those links probably just go to the text, which is the login manifestation of them. So I can show you how, at the end of the talk, how to get to the issue numbers.
There's a link.
Yeah.
Cool. What's new? The new success criteria I can recommend for WCAG, as I mentioned, the old ones have been inherited. And we're going to go through all the new ones for A and AA. We'll touch a bit if you have time on the AAA ones, but there's only a few.
Yeah, that's where I'm at.
Cool. And if you have any questions or comments during the presentation, please raise your hand. I'll give them back to you, and you can ask, so we can actually have a little bit of a discussion and Q&A on the individual criteria if anything pops up.
And the first thing is that every one of the success criteria that are in 2.0 are also in 2.1. So if you meet the 2.1, you will meet the 2.0 also. That was one of the criteria we had, the acceptance criteria for WCAG 2.1.
Cool, let's go. So level A, authentication does not force people to recall a password.
Okay, so this was from the Cognitive Task Force. And they're basically saying, you know, it's really, really tough to memorize numbers, memorize your passwords, all that kind of thing. So you have to be able to reset the password to your link, which most people are doing these days. This just formalizes it. Or you need to be able to just get it in there easily if you're copy and paste, you know, to get it sent to you. So, in other words, the whole idea of, okay, you have to add these fractions in order to get into the your authentication, that kind of thing. You don't want to be a failure if you're relying on it. You can use it, but you can't rely on it.
So, from an application and practical perspective, using the standard password and subnets, as was mentioned, that's super great. Slack is a great feature where you can, it's just a password reset link, but they can just request it instead of dealing with a password. Or using a social login that allows people to kind of bypass the standard recall methods. So if you have OAuth, Facebook login, Twitter login, Google, all of those contributed modules, that actually helps to improve the situation.
What about the case? I filled out a form recently on the Canadian immigration website, and it forced me, when setting up a password, to enter it twice. And the second time, I wasn't allowed to copy and paste into it. It was obviously forcing me to make sure that I knew what it was. But like, is that something that is kind of handled? Like, does that pass? Does that like?
Well, the interesting thing is. Is this particular success criteria is very fluid right now. There's a lot of stakeholders, and there's a lot at stake. So I wouldn't say right now that it's going to fail, as long as you don't have to memorize it. You know, now the whole copy and paste is not going to get a copy and paste. Is there another way? Can you get sent that password again? If you can't, then that would fail this. So that would fail as a success rate. Yeah. And interestingly enough, and like I say, there's going to be a lot of stakeholders. This is the first draft that's coming out as a full kind of consensus document. So these ones that you've seen right now, the entire group is voted yes for, but some of them, they've been voted for yes with a little bit more of a caveat. We want to find out what the world says, sort of thing. So it'll be interesting to see that.
So,
yes.
So do we know when you're bringing up the guidelines, whether they're A, AA, or?
Yeah, these are the single A first, and we're going to do the AAs.
Cool. So next one on them. Can we just look at the handheld mic turned down a little bit? It's very sensitive, like me. Cool. So people must be able to override keyboard shortcuts. The actual name of this success criteria is character key shortcuts.
Okay, so what is this all about? So people who are using Dragon actually speaking, they want to see the word happy. And you've hijacked a key to close down, you've got a web app that closes down the email section and opens up another cache bar and you get the key, right? So the main user, and then you have the Y key hijacked. So they say the word happy, and it's actually just doing a string of characters. And all of the actions that are associated with that word are actually becoming the actions of happy. So this requirement will actually stop that, and you have to do a combination. It's a much, much less likely that you'll accidentally trigger using Dragon Action Speaking if you have more than one key together. However, you can use the single key, but then you have to be able to turn it off. So Google has a single key shortcuts, it's so busy at home. And as long as they have preferences, you can turn them off. That's fine. But you can turn them off or map it to streaming hierarchies. Does that make sense? And I think maybe each one of these actually want to have a vote of what you think is a good idea, not sure, or it's a bad idea. Okay? So let's just go back to the first one. Who thought this the first one was a good idea?
First one.
Okay, how many people think it's kind of, I'm not sure. Yes, you sense. How many think it's going to be really problematic? Okay, we got some.
Ooh.
Yeah, big city of Ottawa.
It doesn't solve anything.
Hold on, that's a 19.
You said the solution is sorry, I don't see how it solves anything. And I force you to recall the password on my website, but I can say, oh, you can run an email, or you can use your Facebook password.
And be quite honest, I'd like to say right now, is I haven't actually defended this successor theory very much, because I think there are problems with it,
that's a problem of everyone uses the same password on the same website, right? Like password overload. So I'm not going to solve on my website password overload. It's technology that's going to have to solve it. So if you ban password altogether, say unless you use some other course of authentication, then maybe that would solve it. But this is kind of a half measure.
Yeah.
If I could add a note, it's forcing people to recall, but it could be using a password manager. So the issue is I can't copy and paste, or I can't use a password manager to apply that password to the textbook for me. I have to physically type it in. So the website with a new password blocking apps would fail, but potentially a website that has a lot of passwords that you can use a tool set, such as a password manager, to pull it out of the email.
Yes, you have to reset your password.
Yeah,
you
have to get a password.
You need to be able to reset your password.
If you're forcing us to use a password manager, which is a security best practice, you help us. Then this all takes a little bit.
Yeah. And let's take that conversation offline. I'm very interested in your thoughts tonight. And I'm quite often go back to the group after when I do these talks. And I say, hey, we've got this concern in the back, So let's talk offline. That's great.
Do you want to
Okay, so who thinks that this is a really good idea, in order to limit, and who thinks it's going to work well to solve the problem for these kind of matches? Yes, it's got quite a bit of momentum here. How many people are not sure though? Okay, a couple of hands. How many people think it's a good idea? Okay,
I'd love to go off and see that one of the challenges with keyboard shortcuts is how do you deal with multiple content? And a lot of times like the control P works great for English, but it doesn't work great for every language. So forcing people to go off and provide for customization of custom keys, having ways to...
That would be very hard.
That would be a better approach if you could provide
that. We tried to get that in. We didn't get consensus on it. Because it would mean a lot of extra work by the developers.
And that's what we're going to do.
Yeah.
We're just trying to keep our jobs, okay?
Yeah.
Cool. I'm going to keep clipping along. We're still on level A. So next one is people can only or can use only one finger or one touch point. The actual machine, the title is pointer gestures. And that would be not forcing a user to have to use two touch points, such as pinch or zoom or double, triple, quadruple swipe in the interface.
Yeah, basically saying you can use all those things, but provide another way to do with one finger. Or so that's required already, but you have to do everything on the keyboard, all your functionality has to work with the keyboard. However, we're in a mobile world now, so this is an issue.
So I kind of wish there was an addendum to this that said that the target area had to be I'm helping my mother who has tremor, and I know lots of people have tremor, and these tiny target areas.
That's coming. It is. You got to do that.
Literally,
yeah. So, did you get the idea? How many think it's a good idea? How many think it's not sure? And how many people think it's a bad idea? Okay. should probably take some notes on that.
It's not so much that I think it's a bad idea, I think it's impractical.
It's impractical, yeah.
And especially because it brings a lot of development in terms of GIS and models. I did a lot of work in GIS recently, and the burden of trying to make something through one touch point or one finger click. Maps are not accessible to start with. So going this far is just astronomical.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk offline, but.
Mike, please.
I assume you're talking about on the keystroke.
Well, no, but then that keystroke. You have to get it with the keyboard, which we already require that. 2.1. This is already required. However, they're basically saying, and there's also a provision in there, an exception. A lot of these have exceptions, and we have language in the success criterion that, you know, they need to be essential to the functionality. And so there's a definition of essential in the WCAG, you can look that up, and there's an essential. Clause on this guy. If it's essential to functionality and you can't do it another way, then you go forward. So that's hopefully that would address your concern.
Cool, next one. We kind of discussed the name.
Yep.
Equivalent labels exist for visual and non-visual users. So the intention here is that if a non-sighted user goes through your form, they would see or comprehend the same labels as a sighted user would be going through. So any kind of short names, adjusted labels, that content is available for both these users. Because frequently developers tend to use more abbreviated text when developing IDs, labels, names. So if somebody has the label such as full name or there's additional context provided by visual elements, that's also available for non-visual users.
Yeah, so this again is for dragging. We were trying to, you know, in our first, we got a lot of criticisms of WCAG too, because we're very blindness oriented. And there's a lot of help to blind people with some of the other people with disabilities groups who are representing people with disabilities. But there was an underrepresentation. There's a good reason for that, because at the time this is line was quite mature. I mean, screeners have been around since the 80s, mid-80s, you know. And so they were mature with WCAG 1 came out, WCAG 2 came out, they're very mature. There's not a lot of assistive technology right now for people with disabilities. There still isn't a way really to simplify language in a meaningful way for people with disabilities. There should be, you know, we should have that right now. We should be able to, you know, instead of translating English to French, go from English grade, you know, in your second year university to English grade 5. Right? We should be able to do that right now. You know? Hopefully, you know, with Watson and various different AI, we'll be able to do more of that. But this guy here is actually for people who are using pragmatic speaking. And say you've got a button, and this button says go. Okay, so the visual label is go. And then on the input next to it, it says search. Okay, so the person says, with their magnet speaking, click go. Nothing happens. Right? So in other words, if you have a visual label and you have a hidden label, there has to be the text of the visual label has to be contained within the hidden label. So even if it's a go search, then the person could say go, and it would click go, and it would work. So that's what does everybody kind of understand the idea? Yeah, think it's a good idea? Yeah, one hands up. Moderated? Okay.
The problem with the way that comes to mind is that it says they have to be equivalent. So let's say you have an address form and there's two input elements, one after the other, and it says address. You can see this, it's obvious that it's, you know, address line 1, address line 2. You might want to have a visually hidden label, which clearly identifies the second one as address line 2. You don't want to display that visually, you don't need to. Somebody can see it, it's obvious what it means, but on screen reader, you want to have that label there. Equivalent would suggest that you need to display
You actually should be displaying, you should have a visual label for every input. Particularly troublesome are R3, like telephone number, first three, second three, four. But these are classic accessibility problems. You should probably be using a visual label anyway. However, this would just require that, I'm trying to think how that would work. So you have address at the top, this is one, this is address two. I would say address one, address two, that's like the most of that. Simple. Some people would actually wonder what they're supposed to put in there. That's not everybody would actually get that object with disability would actually understand, oh yeah, that's both ways. However, I think in that particular situation, if you had an address on there, what do I mean? You go to the first one, and then let's go to the second one, they're the same. So it says click address, you'll put the number 1, 2 up, and then you sort of select two. Now most people use Dragon visually. If you're blind and you're using Dragon, I teach people who are blind, and I've had one user who wanted to use Dragon. It's a very, very difficult thing to use both of them together. Very, very difficult. Anybody think it's a bad idea? Okay, so it's good.
I just want to go into this. It's also useful. Dragon actually speaking users is more of them, I think, than other voice than screening users. So people often underrepresent that, but also you've got all the future automation of like Amazon Home and Echo and whatnot, or Google Home and Amazon Echo. You've got these things that are coming about, which you're going to need to use these. So this is good for everyone if you're trying to build these best practices. So I'm quite happy about that.
Great. Sure.
I have a question. I've never tested this, but sometimes it forms in advances automatically. So instead of tapping to the next field, it just does it. The system does it. Does the text-to-speech system read out the label?
Yeah, if you get thrown to the next field, which is not a very bad practice, but if you do get thrown to the next field, it will read the label to you. As soon as your focus enters in there, it'll make the accessibility, which is whether it's the acronym or the label or whatever. So it will read, it's bad practice.
It's bad practice.
Yeah, it's bad practice.
I know, because I find it really annoying. Because you're like, well, it's okay.
She finds it annoying.
Because you don't know, you're tapping away and it's already gone fast.
So far we have the first one got a little bit of, wasn't sure, but pretty well since then, and we've put a bit of momentum, it sounds like. Cool.
So this one, we're still on level A. Events are triggered on touch up, so this is called accidental activation. So there's three stages to a click, the down, the press, and the up. If you're handling stuff with JavaScript, you're going to run into this. So in general, this would be for if you're doing any custom click handling, make sure you're only activating the action on the touch up. If you use the standard jQuery click method, which is bundled into core, you will be doing absolutely fine. So this is again one of the ones where if you hijack it, you try to do something fancy, you will get in trouble.
Yeah, and you'll find a lot of these in this weekend. This is basically don't do dumb stuff. Now if you've got a piano program,
this isn't my mother.
If you have a piano program, you don't want to have it on the touch-up there, right? So we have the essential exception in there also. If you're a shooting gallery, you pull the trigger and you shoot the bullet, you have to let go. That would be not a very fun game, right? So you do have the exception on there. But generally, if you use all of the regular mechanisms, this is really helps people if they have trouble getting the right direction, finding the right point. They can actually move over to it and then lift up and get it to trigger. Otherwise, if it's on down, as soon as they press the wrong thing, it'll accidentally trigger on. So it gives them a little bit more time to think before they let go. Make sense? How many people think it's a good idea? Okay. How many people think it's not sure? Okay, tell me.
I was expecting a third action. Getting a word out here. I guess it depends on the exception cases. So like, this is like, I'm thinking like a scroll bar. So if you click on the scroll bar, it goes down a bit. If you click and hold the scroll bar, it goes down. Like, I guess it's versus, I guess the touch up more like it's sort of like hold in the press or touch down.
Well, actually, when you click the scroll bar once, it's on the outfit and still.
Yeah.
So you're
but also, you also hold and then it'll hold down too. So it happens on press and up.
That's actually a good consideration.
Yeah. So.
Frequently, the hold stage is like adjust the magnitude of whatever you're tracking. So if you hold really, really long, as you said, like you scroll for very long time and then look up, then that would indicate momentum. Or if you're charging up your laser cannon.
The sticky keys.
Yeah. How's the difference between hold and trigger work when you're using sticky keys?
Sticky keys is keyboard is basically holding the control key. So it's actually not part of the website. It's part of the operating system. Sticky keys are part of Windows. So it's not affected at all. It's its own this technology. But it's not a part of the web. Creating your own sticky keys, you know, if you're trying to do something like that, like say it was a typing.
But how is it mapped? Like if you've got in your browser, you've got like the ability to pull down, like you say, and scroll up in your scroll mechanism, either to take the either button or the page when you're scrolling.
Okay, so
they're mapping, sticky keys are mapping to one of those. Which one would it be?
Well, I'm not sure. When you say sticky keys, do you mean mouse keys? I think you might be meaning mouse keys. Yeah, I think you might be meaning mouse keys, where you map the number pad to the mouse. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's a different part of that suite of accessibility stuff. So mouse keys works the same way as mouse exactly. So you hold down the arrow key. It's still part of your operating system. There's nothing an author can do to override the sticky keys behavior. It just maps actually mouse in Windows. So I don't see anything overlap there.
Yeah. I mean, it's not.
But the whole position, that's an important consideration. I'll think about it. Appreciate that.
Another reason why talking into the mic is really important is that this is getting recorded, so you can back to your document and you can find out what the heck you're talking about 6 months down the road. Cool, so the next one is device sensors. So this is to provide another way for get device sensors info. So the example here, and I find that this is really important to understand it, is if your application depends on shaking, tilting, orientation, you don't force just that method, there can be other ways to get that information. So if you shake to undo, there would also be another way for a user to undo an action.
Yeah, so this one, I'll just tell you up front, there's quite a bit of discussion going on now with this particular one. It's out there, there's a lot of public comment on it. I have a concern with it because it actually has already been met by the WCAG 2.1.1, which is about a keyboard, making sure that everything works with a keyboard. So they say it must provide another way, you know, this is actually not the exact language of it, but the exact language of it, let's just pull that up. Yeah, there we go. Great. So the all functionality of the content can be operated without requiring specific device sensor information unless the device sensor is essential for the function and not using it to validate the activity. So they do have an exception, so that's where it got through. But however, we only require all functionality in order of a keyboard. So if you meet 3.1.1, you're going to need this. Now there's people in the group who feel that we need to do some things to it to make sure that it can still make things work on mobile, not just keyboard. And so that's what we're exploring over these next couple of months. 2.1 candidate recommendation going out in December, so within 4 months, this next 4 months, we're going to decide. But there's my concern on it, but a lot of people are quite, you know, they think it's a really good idea. And I've learned over the years, I've been you know, since 2002, I learned that when I have an opinion on something and I see other different opinions, it's very important to listen to those other opinions and to see what, you know, what people are thinking. And so, so I'm interested in what your thoughts are. How many people think this is a good idea to pursue further? How many people think that's way too wide? Or, and how many people think it's really good? So we'll start with, how many people think it's a really good idea? We should get it in some form. Okay, so not a lot of momentum here. Like Shane, you said,
the device is great, but you can't necessarily assume, like, maybe you've got a phone with the motion sensor book, or having somebody that
can't see. Another way to do it besides the motion, yeah. Like if you shave to undo, well, you should have an undo fixture somewhere where you can do it, right? That's really what they're requiring, you know, geometrics, and that plus is essential. So when you're out in the woods, you know, you have to have another means to do this geo, you know, find your car. More difficult. So anyway, what do people think it's an okay good idea? Or, so Mike, you're saying yes, you like it. Is that right? Yeah. How many other people think it's a good idea? How many people not sure? Lots of not sure. How many people think it's a bad idea? Okay, so
a lot of ambivalence there. It's kind of how I feel too, to be honest. And I'm just taking this down because I'll take it back to the group. You guys are making a difference right now. You're changing the force of history.
So just on that, my concern would be, I think you're focusing on technology there because you're thinking of maybe the change on you or one or two different sensors that exist today, but that does not include what's coming 1 year, 2 years, 5 years down the road.
There's one. So I'm in meetings. Exactly what you're saying. You're exactly right. It's going to happen. If it's going to get through, you know, big A, it's going to happen. Because it's way too wide in scope. That's what you're saying.
And just to follow up on that, there is a body of opinion that says that really accessibility and universality are not necessarily goals that are achievable, and maybe it should be. Hard to phrase this, but it's that working towards universality can be a kind of an endgame that is a little bit.
So it feels a little heavy handed, and it's endgame way of vision.
Yeah, because, so you're saying yes, because most of the people that I work with that are that are facing issues of disability, they actually have devices that are specific to their particular needs, and that is kind of. That is, in a way, a better route. Working towards universality can be problematic because there are holes, and the holes, you know, can't be addressed, and some people give up.
Okay. So that's a very deep philosophical discussion we can have. it's not unlike a discussion of apps versus the web, right?
Yeah, well, like
it's kind of one of those discussions. A lot of opinions on that.
I don't think it's a bad idea, but I think if we add that explanation into the keyboard accessibility, it'd be much better.
So there's people in that camp also. We're a little nervous to open up 2.1.1 because as soon as you open something up, it's like Pandora's box and everybody wants to change things, and then people say, they changed the WCAG. And there's a requirement we have that nothing changes out of the WCAG 2 in order to add on the 2.1. So there's a little bit of political issues of whether we want to start merging and stuff. And we're going to be looking at that, though, whether we should merge this into 2.1. There's people who are saying that also, which is a good point. Okay, well, that gives me a lot of good information. Okay.
We're finally on the delay. So this is a bit more scripted. This is one I'm really excited about. So Zoom content, the phrasing of this is interesting, but the functional aspect of it is that you have to have responsive design down to approximately 320 pixels, which, fingers crossed, everyone is already doing, but it's at least there.
Yes.
And
go ahead.
If you're using the out-of-the-box admin menu from Drupal 7, this is going to be running into it from before because it's not by default,
it's not responsive, but that means that there's a lot of, again, responsive design because of best practices that are going on. This is just kind of enforcing that and defining it a little more clearly.
Yeah, so this had a lot of discussion, and one of the best things that ever happened to World Vision in the last decade is responsive design. Because people are on their desktop, they hit that control plus with their wheel, the thing opens up, and in the old days, they'd have to horizontally scroll across and like read a line of text. And when you start scrolling across finished lines of text, you're talking about a lot of cognitive load. The low vision community has been trying to solve this linearization, to keep everything within the group order and wrap properly for years. And as soon as responsive design came out, it was just like, great, I'm magnifying the thing, suddenly it goes into the viewport. So people are looking at a mobile view on 24-inch screens. Just know that. There's a lot of people doing that, you know? And so it's really important, it's huge. Now, we have considerations. In China, there's not much responsive designs right now. In a lot of Asian countries, they're not using responsive design right now. So we're not sure what's going to happen. We really want this to get through. We hope it's going to get through. North American, first world, Europe, it's not going to be hard. And then we'll have to make a decision at some point whether we're just going to push it through and say, hey, this is a good program. This is what needs to happen. Go ahead and do it. I'm leaning on that every once in a while. We do kind of just push something, a really great idea through, and responsive is a really great idea. Now, there are lots of exceptions in here. So this was worked on for a couple of years. And, it's basically, there's some exceptions, except for parts of the content that require two-dimensional layout or usage. So it's talking about tables, tables that are big wide tables that you can't get into responsive, or, that kind of thing. So there are some images, large images, that type of thing. So there are some situations where it may be required to horizontally zoom, but most, this is really going to give a lot of teeth to the WCAG 2.1 for low vision communities.
So there's a discussion. I've done a lot of work with publishing, which is now part of W3C. There's a new, it's a bunch of solutions for tables to come down, and one of them is, which I think is really neat, is to take all of the headings and apply them as.
Yeah, there's a lot of responses going on with tables now. There's a lot of great work happening with it, but we're not going to require it because it's just a little bit too fluid right now. So we're not going to require responsive tables because there's going to be situations where this is just not appropriate. And, we're going to, of course, we'll have the best practices in there, but the WCAG, you can't quite be so heavy-handed and have some exceptions on some of the things. Otherwise, it just won't get accepted for the report, and the legislation won't pass it.
I'll wait for Ricky later.
She drives her bike everywhere. She goes across the country in her bicycle. Yeah, Erin is a real bicycle main person. Yeah. So this is nothing for her. She's just
doing her exercise for her next bike trip. you mentioned that there's not much response happening in China. Is that due to the nature of the way they read the language, or is it just like an education?
You know what? I don't think it's language because there's some response with Japan and stuff. So, no, I don't think it's got anything to do with the characters. I think it's just a cultural thing that just hasn't happened yet.
It might be because of the more adoption for apps instead of web apps. So more people are on their phones using those kind of
things. Yeah, we don't really know the reason for it, to be honest. We just have heard that, and we don't even have first-hand experiences. People have told us that we may want to watch out for that when we push this through.
Cool, we're getting down to work. Conventional names of elements can be determined programmatically, but it didn't fit in here, so. What this is that if you're using, again, short names, IDs, machine names, and elements, they can be, using programmatic methods, you can determine what it is. So if you have a first name field, the name of the field should probably be first name, as an example of that.
Yeah, the cognitive community has had a really hard time knowing what stuff is. We have a conventional name, the ACK name, the accessible name,
But a lot of times, if people are not using the convention name, like your whole name, or your contact, first name, last name, all those things, there's actually a list of 50 of them, HTML5, 50 HTML, actually 75, you know, kind of the drop-down list of different inputs. What they want to do eventually is the cognitive community is looking to have a recognizable, programmatically recognizable way to identify common elements and then strip everything else off the page with assistive technology. So they'll take your page and they'll strip it down in your assistive technology so they can just see what's really, really important for the things. And so this is actually just kind of laying a landing pad for that in the next version of WCAG, basically. Getting people used to the idea, and it's still very fluid right now. It's one of those things, I'm not sure if we'll get into 2.1 or not. We have some pretty serious discussions about it. However, what it will eventually do is that there'll be a set of extensions, like Way Area, for cognitive, and it'll basically say what the thing is. You know, and you'll have a priority level. And you know, and so that you can actually simplify pages based on the priority level of the attributes. I'm not sure what it's a really great idea. I don't know whether it's gonna make it in the real world or not. You know, we're hoping that something will happen to help the cognitive community better. And this is one of the things. So what this is doing is basically laying the groundwork for that. We're gonna probably come up with about 15 elements that you have to use a conventional name or provide a conventional name programmatically so that it can be identified.
Another interesting part of this is the impact for machine users. So as was mentioned, Alexa Home or any kind of crawling device, they'll be able to properly parse and understand what's going on.
Wait. There's definitely places where first name and last name are not part of the culture. So the conventions, like those are Western conventions. How do you deal with broader issues or address fields? Like, there are places that don't have addresses. You can't send something to a house address in the Northwest Territories, for instance.
Yeah, so internationalization, this has gone through a whole bunch of iterations, and this latest version has been accepted conditionally, and there is a note on it about internationalization concerns, and also you know, the development of the assistive technology for the level of development. So you're coming up with a concern that other people have raised with it, and it's a very big concern.
Cool. We're going to keep clicking along. So we have graphic contrast minimums. The contrast minimums have been bumped up for large and small text. In general, it's similar patterns as we have been using before, but the values have just changed.
Yeah, actually, I have to correct that. nothing's changed in text. It's only that graphical information now will adopt the same standards as text. In other words, if you have a graph, a bar graph, you know, that you have to be able to distinguish it from anything next to it. So whenever you have important information, you have definition of the formal and definition of important information that is critical to the understanding of the content, that there must be, if you're using graphics, there must be a distinguishing in the color contrast of the important information. So that's that. So it's been extended on that, and it's getting pretty good momentum. I think it'll probably bump down to just one level rather than having 4.5 and 3:1. I think on the final draft it'll just be 3:1, because my argument is that it's not as hard to cognitively parse a thing than a word. Word takes more cognitive load and hard, more distinction in the reading ability. So I expect that to go down to 3:1, and that will also go for focus indicators. You know, when you use a natural focus indicator, if you use a natural focus indicator, fine. But if you lighten up that focus indicator, you know, we're going to have to now, in this next version, have it so that when people hit the tab, they can actually see where the focus is, which is a booking new requirement. Does that make sense? And the buttons, interface elements and stuff like that also. Yeah.
Oh.
Pictures.
Yeah. Photos, if it's got important, no. like photographs. No, graphical information in the image distinction between photographs, I don't think we're going to have. I don't think photographs is going to be part of that. That would be a very difficult thing to answer.
Because you like normally have infographics and have the icons.
Oh, infographics. Yeah. I thought you said a photograph. Okay.
Yeah, it's like you say about the graphics.
Okay, yeah.
I'm assuming like bar chart.
Yeah, bar chart, infographics, all that kind of stuff, man-made stuff. If you're taking a picture of a thing, you know, with a camera, it's not going to apply to that.
The next version of WCAG is going to be required Instagram filters.
So this is the related one. I've already said this one. This is the interactive elements part of the buttons. So there's two success criteria broken up, one for graphics and one for interactive elements. Same sort of thing, idea. So it's basically that people with low vision will be able to use your site now. They don't have to start looking around for, you know, alternatives. Yeah, go ahead.
So the contrast ratio, is that like supplemented on top of like focus, like having focus outline?
That's a really great question. So the question is, the button has to have sufficient contrast for the background, plus the focus has to have sufficient contrast for the button and with the background. Is that what your concern is?
Well, yeah, it just seems like we're layering focuses and like contrast on top of contrast, and then red, green, and blue right on top of each other.
Yeah. So the question was, so you have a button that says go, and it's got sufficient contrast, dark blue, one white. Now you've got a black focus indicator, hits that thing, and it doesn't have sufficient contrast with the button. Well, as long as it has sufficient contrast with one side of it, it'll pass.
Okay, so something contrasts with it. Okay.
Yeah. And we've also thought about CSS to allow for there to be three-color focus indicators. In other words, you have black and thin white on each side of the black. So wherever the focus indicator goes, it'll be visible.
You give a border for the focus indicator?
Yeah, obviously a border for the focus indicator. You know, you're talking about a fine. You only can do that with voiceover. Anybody who's using voiceover, whenever you tap through a voiceover, you'll see there's a black line and there's a little bit of white on each side. You don't usually notice it unless you're on something dark. And then all of a sudden, the focus indicator shows up magically.
Is that the same?
Oh, yes. One question over here, sorry.
It's actually more of a comment, so I'm going to say that the contrast ratios, that's also very important depending on the choice of colors for colorblind people, which is something like 5% of males.
Yeah, so the people who are colorblind is very, very important for, depending on your colorblindness, the hues that you have trouble with colorblindness. There's lots of different types of colorblindness. Red, green is very common. There's probably a few of us who can put our hands up on that one today here.
So essentially the focus would be the selector, the CSS selector outline.
Yeah.
There's a default in most browsers and it would just be, and I'm assuming the default is complex.
There's discussion about that right now.
So, chug along. The next.
Hold on. How many people think these two graphic ideas are a good idea? But man,
I have
too many. Okay. How many people think, not sure? Okay, 1, 2, 3, the developers are kind of thinking about how we're going to make this work. Okay, how many people think it's a good idea? Okay, so stop with the momentum, a few concerns. That you think it's a bad idea?
No, I don't think it's a bad idea.
Okay.
Well, did you want to have a comment?
Yeah. It's not a bad idea, but it's already developed, which means the market succeeds.
I walked into a meeting one time and they said, we just got a new college, we paid $100,000 for it. And I looked at them and I'm like, okay, so why don't you bring them in for me?
I know that now for technology guys, it would be nice to have a button and they just change your colors in a scale at the markets.
Google has that now. If you can get the Google Accessibility High Contrast module, and it'll actually do a really great job of giving you different contrast ratios. It's still really good, it's starting to get solved, but we can't rely on these tools at this point.
From a design perspective, there's plugins to empower design to actually check the broadcast radios. They can do that already, and I found that if you have a poor monitor, frequently designers have those very fancy $5,000 Apple monitors. If you have a monitor with lower color contrast, you can show them like this in your problem areas, they can very visually see it.
Okay, so the next one, this one here is actually the goal vision community really wants. So at least some parts of the goal vision community really want this. It's about them being able to override using a plugin your store CSS. And basically, it's requiring, we want to get a look at the text of it actually, yeah. So they want, you don't have to do anything, just don't interfere with it. Their ability to override the line height, spacing underneath the paragraphs to at least two times the font size, letter spacing, and the word spacing. So these are four things that they want to be able to control without messing up the content. And with their own tools, basically. So you're not interfering with that. Is that understandable?
How would you be interfering with that? Like if they have the one last one on the CSS, they can do anything they want to.
If your layout, if you use fixed layouts or you don't tie all of your padding and margins to the font size or the font tracking, that's when lines can push further or override stuff.
We're getting close, eh?
Oh my god.
Anyway, how many people think this is a good idea? Yeah, how many people think you're not sure? Okay, and how many people think it's bad? Okay, so it's got three good momentum. Good to know. Thank you.
Oh my god, we got like 5 minutes still. Okay. Tool tips that appear on hover or focus are easy to interact with. And this one was a very interesting one for David to explain to me. So my understanding of this is that if there's a tooltip or additional content that is appearing on hover or focus, it doesn't override the interface that triggers it, so it doesn't hover over it, and you just easily enter it and exit it and understand the context of it.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, so it's originally started out with the title attribution, and it's such a mess for the poor one, the low vision community. Low vision community, zooming on something, and then also title attribution taking away everything. We couldn't really do anything about that because it's a browser issue. It's not an author issue, it's a browser issue. We can't find the context of title attribute, and there's sometimes which is really useful. So we just abandoned that. However, if you use a custom tooltip, so you hover on something, let's say, hey, Air Canada, they got the price, and then they show you a breakdown. The price will pop up and hover over. Anybody see those guys, you know? So that kind of thing, the infograph, more information comes up. So we already require in WCAG, the keyboard 2.1.1, that when it gets focused, it's actually activate the thing. However, we didn't have anything that requires it to maintain the visibility of the button that triggered it. And also we didn't require that people could actually move into the with their keyboard or with their mouse without actually creating a closing on it. A lot of people in the low vision community who are magnifying stuff, they'll have these pop-ups go and then they'll go there and the thing will disappear on them. They can't read it, right? So it just basically says as long as you're hovering over it and you're focusing it, it stays open and you don't obscure the button that triggered it. Is that understandable? Yeah.
So when that conflict with the 320 pixel minimum, is like, I see your tooltips, a lot of text in it, it might just push that stuff right off the page. You know, you can't actually see the text anymore below your tooltip. I mean, that's just
yeah.
That's
a good consideration. I think you're fine. I'm thinking about if you're saying that it's got the tooltip is up and the button is moved off screen, so the button's moved off screen.
It's still technically focused,
but it hasn't been the button is not the pop-up is not obscured. It's just the way the content is scrolled.
Right.
So that wouldn't fail. That would fail this success rate.
So for sake of time, I'm going to be a bully, David.
Sure.
And I'm going to skip the remaining ones. I'm going to summarize up. There's lots more. You have a really excellent blog post that is consistently updated where you can go through the individual ones and see them. And you can also provide feedback.
I can actually type that for everybody if you want. If you should pull up a Word document or something, I'll type it in there. Right?
I'll tweet it.
Sure.
I'll tweet out the links to the slides and everything there. But here, in terms of feedback, we're looking for specifically 4 points. And feedback regarding that. Is it testable? Is it implementable? Is it scalable? And is it actually doable at all? Or is this too much of a barrier to actually go?
And is it internationalizing? Does it move across technologies, technology independent? And is it also global internationalization and requirements? I really appreciate your time. I think that's the end of our
talk. That's it. Thank you so much.